was beautiful. Just talking to one of our brothers with Wycliffe here and about the vision of Wycliffe to see scripture in every language by the year 2025. I think the number of scriptures in the world today, or languages in the world today, without a single word of scripture, are around 1900. And so we want to end biblical illiteracy and biblical famine, and maybe our readings today would just give us a vision for that. So, well, it's so good to be back. Since I saw you last, I've crossed two things off my bucket list in my life. Yes, last night I got to see the Chicago Cubs play in Wrigley. And they won. Yes. And the good news is that they're only 18 games out of first place now instead of 19. But we're hoping, they have some good prospects, and we're hoping for a good season next year. I guess we've been saying that for 100 years now, right? So, but yeah, I know so many suffering Cubs fans, and I want to be a Cubs fan, but I'm a Braves fan, so but that was good. But also on the way, I experienced some very excellent Chicago cuisine last night at a certain Super Dogs. Anyone been there? That is some gorgeous food there. That is Chicago dog at its finest. Actually, when I opened it up, I couldn't even find the hot dog in there at first. There are these, it was buried in fries and things like that, stuff that's really good for us. And to top it all off, because I'd had such a nutritious meal, we were coming home on the Metro, and I was assured by reliable sources that at the Lake Forest stop that there were taxis, and there were not. And so I asked Siri, please find me a taxi, and so I called and got through to one taxi company, and then we lost the connection and kept following them back. And so we took home a special taxi. They call it in North Africa Taxi Hadash. That's the number 11 taxi. Okay, this is one, this is one. So at 11 o'clock last night, we walked home about 2.5 miles, and we're still here. And I took it easy this morning. So, well, by the way, speaking of food, I'm totally open for dinner tonight. And I have a dining hall pass into the Waybright, and that's burning a hole in my pocket. So if anyone would like to get together for dinner and just talk or hang out, nothing in particular, please come afterwards and we can make plans. I don't know what time you have dinner. I usually sometime in the evening, right? 5-ish, 6-ish. So love to hear your story and talk a little bit more if you'd like to. Anyone? So a group or. So, on Monday, we raised some big issues about mission in a diaspora world and the state of the world. And the world can be a pretty depressing place with things going on. And so it certainly begs the question, how do we respond? What should we do in light of all of this? And I want to bring your attention to one group of activists, not Christian missionaries, but another group, and how they have sought to deal with the problem of the rainforests. A lot to think about there, huh? A friend of mine this morning, this is called the Follow the Frog video, and it goes on with some other things you can look at on YouTube, but I told him, I said, we're going to look at Follow the Frog in chapel, and he texted back, he says, I'm going to save you! And sometimes when we look at the world, even as Christians, we might have this attitude or not. And so how do we respond as Christians with the challenges of the world in the diaspora mobile world that we live in? Well, one of the things that's really good is just to begin by saying, what is Christian mission? Now, there's a historian, a missionary to India, Stephen Neal, of the 20th century, that said, when mission becomes everything, mission is nothing. And one of the things I observe in the 21st century is that mission is used in lots of context. And the way that I define Christian mission is God's initiative to send his people, his ambassadors, to proclaim his salvation and his ways among the nations. And so a couple of things there. Mission, and we've heard it said a few times this week, it's God's mission. It's God's initiative. Christ said, all authority in heaven on earth has been given to me. It's God's idea and God's power. And even when we see in the opening chapters of Genesis, after Adam and Eve fall, the first responder on the scene asking the question, where are you, is God himself. God is a missionary God who invites us to join him in this cosmic redemptive plan that's laid out through the pages of Scripture. Well, what are the actions of mission? What do missionaries do? Well, certainly they proclaim the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. And I would say that if we're leaving that out of our mission, then we're not distinctively Christian in our mission anymore. We're not distinctive from the Follow the Frog, Save the Rainforest campaign if we miss the heart of the gospel in mission. But there are other things. When people believe, when groups of people believe, and in lots of the world, most of the world, I think, most people don't make individual personal decisions for Jesus. In fact, I don't think I made an individual personal decision for Jesus because it affected my family relationships. It affected my whole life and all of my relationships. It wasn't individual and personal. It affected my community and my surroundings. But as people come to faith, they often come to faith together. And I was just reminded this morning of the privilege of several years ago getting to baptize a North African family who had come to faith together. In fact, individual members of the family had come to Christ. And the father was the last one to believe, which is often the case. And they waited to be publicly baptized until they could do so as a family and stand together as a family. But as peoples come to Christ, we plant churches that plant churches. I was part of a church planting team where we believed in planting pregnant churches. Churches that plant churches. An expression of the body of Christ, of God's kingdom. But certainly there are other actions and tasks like translating scripture, as we've mentioned, and other things like humanitarian work and community development. And I have students in our community development degree that are doing incredible things around the world in sustainable agriculture. I was just aware of a team in Eastern Europe working among Muslims that have developed a very good raspberry business through year-round agriculture. And this is an incredible thing. And even our students are planning to plant a community garden on our campus so that we can better connect with our community. And of course, we ask the question, where is the gospel in proclaiming Jesus in that? So we proclaim the gospel in word and in deed. One of the things that I observe is that as we serve together in mission, there are people in teams as a body. There are people with different gifts that bring different things to the table. And so when I lived overseas, my friend Jack was a good business entrepreneur. And he was good at starting businesses. Another friend of mine was really good with IT. And so there were some translation projects going on that really required work in the area of IT, and he was great for it. Another of my teammates, she was great at bringing people together in Bible study and the beginning of churches. And these gifts complemented one another. And so we do different things. Well, when we ask the question, one of the questions about mission is every Christian a missionary? I've heard it sometimes said, you're either a mission field or you're a missionary. Or sometimes we talk about people talking about their call to being a missionary. And so, is every Christian a missionary? That's actually something that Nicholas von Zinzendorf, who initiated the Moravian movement, he kind of talked in that language. Was he correct in saying that every Christian is a missionary? Well, one of the things that I suggest we do instead of giving you my thoughts and opinion right now, why don't we dig into the scriptures that we've so nicely heard and see how one example of a New Testament church begins to answer this question for us. And we've already read, and you have it on the screen there. By the way, that was beautiful pidgin Cameroonian English there. I wish I could do that. But some of the things that we observe from the church at Antioch that we start to learn about at the end of Acts 11. If we go back to Acts chapter 7, Stephen is martyred and put to death. And there is great dispersion from the church of Jerusalem. The Jerusalem Christians are going to Phoenicia. They're going to Cyprus. They're going to Antioch. They are peoples on the move who are fleeing violence because of their profession of faith in Christ. And we see Jewish Christians there. And as they're going to Antioch, which was a very multicultural, cosmopolitan city in the early centuries, they go and they are proclaiming their faith to other Jews. So they don't just have a survival mentality. They are going and they are telling people about Jesus, but just other Jews. But fortunately, we have Christians coming from the island of Cyprus and from Cyrene in North Africa that are talking to other Gentiles as well. And what happens is we see a multicultural church that is planted in Antioch on the heels of suffering and dispersion. The fruit of this dispersion is the church, and it's a church that's on mission. The Jerusalem church sees Barnabas. Barnabas is from Cyprus. He was Jewish, but because of his background, he understood both the Jewish and the Greek world. He is sent there to be a teacher. Now, Barnabas's name means son of encouragement, and so he was a bridge builder. He was an encourager. This was a difficult situation for these people. And it's good to have encouragement and pastoral leadership during that. Well, Barnabas sought out another guy named Saul, who we met back in Acts chapter 9, who had persecuted the church. Saul was a multicultural man. He understood the Jewish world. He understood the Greek world. He understood the Roman world. And after his conversion, Saul, who we know as Paul, spent about 3 years in Arabia, certainly preaching the gospel there, not just on an individual monastic retreat, but he was preaching the gospel, and by this time he's back in his home province of Cilicia in Asia Minor. And Barnabas goes and gets him because for probably a decade, Paul has been involved in cross-cultural ministry, and he would be perfect for this. And so together, Barnabas and Paul, they teach this multicultural church that is planted in Antioch. Well, what happens next? Well, as we heard wonderfully read to us in the Hmong language, is that the church is there worshiping. And notice, I think we have the text up there. Notice the names of the people that are part of the church here. We, of course, have Barnabas, the encourager, originally from the island of Cyprus. We have Simeon called Niger. So probably that refers to that he is sub-Saharan African. So we have an African believer there. We have another African believer, Lucius, from Cyrene in Libya. And Cyrene, of course, is near modern Benghazi, Libya. It's also the home of where Simon, who carried our Lord's cross to Calvary, where he was from. And there were diaspora Jewish communities there before Christ. And interestingly, the first place that we know about of Christianity in Africa is in the city of Cyrene. About the year 100, through archaeological remains, we see the gospel going back there. But Lucius is from Cyrene. Manan was probably Jewish, and he was a friend of Herod and had political connections. And of course, we've mentioned Saul, who was from Tarsus and who had lived around and who was well-educated in Judaism, well-educated in Greek thought, and he was a citizen of Rome. So the leadership of this church is multicultural. And when we look at churches, I think about Mosaic Church in Arkansas, that their leadership is a multicultural leadership team. When we talk about multicultural churches, it shouldn't just be in the congregation, but it should be in the leadership. even though it's difficult and challenging. But this was a church that was witnessing to Gentiles in their own cities. They were teaching the scriptures. They were a worshiping, praying, and fasting church. They were a church that listened to and obeyed the Holy Spirit. And ultimately, they're a church that set apart missionaries that the scripture tells us they send off to the nations. And that is Paul, and that is Barnabas. By the way, I was over here looking at the prayer wall, and let me just encourage you to take advantage of the prayer opportunities this week. This is something that every believer can do. Maybe the idea of mission really scares you. Or maybe you just have no heart for it. It's just not where you are in your life. Let me encourage you just to begin praying about the needs of the world. And praying for, as you take the L into town and you hear different languages spoken, to pray for the nations that are among us here. We've mentioned the Moravians briefly. This was a movement, actually they didn't intend to be a missionary movement, but they were a movement of refugees that came from what is now Czechoslovakia, or the former Czech Republic, former Czechoslovakia, the Czech Republic. And they moved across the border into Germany onto Zinzendorf's estate. And they were just a church, and they were a church actually that struggled. But they began to pray. And after about 5 years of dedicated prayer, they experienced revival and renewal. And shortly after that, about 1 in 60 members of the Moravian community went into the world to be missionaries. And they began, I don't know if you've ever been part of a 24-hour prayer chain, but they started a 24-hour prayer chain. They were praying around the clock, and that went on for about 100 years. And so when we look at the history of Protestant missions, of evangelical missions, it's born on the backs of people that pray. Speaking of Antioch, I was in Brazil a few years ago, interviewing the leaders of the first Brazilian missions organization that is started by Brazilians, sending Brazilians out into the world. Their agency is called Antioch Mission. And one of their core values is prayer. And I went into their training center, and they have a prayer chapel on their campus where they train missionaries to go into the world. And they have been praying almost entirely around the clock since about 1983. And as I walked into their prayer chapel, I felt the weight of God's glory, and I was convicted about how little I pray for the world and how I needed to pray more as people are on their knees. So the great movements of God begin with prayer, and that's something that everyone can do. Well, the church here at Antioch, they lay hands on Paul and Barnabas, and they send them off. And so going back to our original question, was every Christian at Antioch a missionary? Missionary in the sense of one who is sent off to deliberately cross culture and boundaries of belief? I don't think every Christian in the church at Antioch was a missionary in that sense. But everyone in the church of Antioch, through their prayers, through their local outreach, through their sending, through their giving, their supporting, they own the mission of God. It was part of who they were. Now think about who we are today, and I think most students at Trinity are majoring in business, is that right? I think 12% of you are. Some of you are majoring in Christian ministries, training to be in youth ministry, or worship leaders, or pastors. Some of you, I think you have a sports management degree, I think. Is that correct, or sports leadership? Something with the word sports in it, okay? In psychology and other degrees, I wonder if you take what you're studying and think through your gifts, and that's what we're gonna talk a little bit more about on Friday, and just ask the question, Lord, how can I do what I do in my life in light of your command to make disciples of all nations. Not that everyone should go. We don't want everyone to go. We need people to send. We need people to go and start businesses and make a lot of money and fund projects of mission around the world. We need people to win in the marketplace and to live very sacrificially for God's glory. We need people to mobilize and to advocate. We need people to stay in Chicago and reach out to Muslims in the nations that are here. And Dave Childers, who's here with World Venture, we were at the Cubs game last night, and as we were enjoying the win, he's a part of a network of about 40 people that are reaching Muslims right here in Chicago. And so the going is not very far at times. But are you called to be a missionary? I don't know if that's the best question. I would start with the question, are you called to Christ? And we're all called to Christ. And when we're called to God, we're called to live for his glory and for his glory to spread. You might want to mute that next time. does that mean time's up, I think? We want to love what God loves. And God loves the nations. And we've heard the scriptures read in an African dialect. We've heard it in an Asian dialect. And there are more people. We need to end unworship in the world. And we want to see God's name praised among the nations. And all of us have a part in that. That's what we'll talk a little bit more about on Friday. Let's pray together.